certainly. It's always a pleasure to talk about the hermetically sealed subject.
Absolutely. I'm looking forward to this very much here. So why don't we begin just talk a little bit about yourself. Kind of tell us a little bit about your background and how you got involved in some of this research, Frank.
Certainly. Well, I'm presently a doctoral student at the University of Cambridge in England. And if somebody had asked me 5 years ago that I'd be exploring the Masonic and Freemasonic influences in public architecture, I would have thought, you know, that's absolutely ludicrous. But basically, I was spawned on this subject about 6 years ago when I stumbled upon some rather arcane symbolism that adorns a legislative building in my hometown of Winnipeg. What happened was I just noted these two giant Egyptian sphinxes that flank the front entrance of this building. And at that time, I was doing a master's degree in basically the Hebrew Bible and the ancient Middle East. And so over the last 6 years, I've sort of been on an academic odyssey trying to figure out how this building relates to a much larger question, which is it possible that architecture and buildings and form can affect a person's mind, their soul, whatever. So the subject of my research presently is basically looking at the Western esoteric tradition, in particular Freemasonry, and its impact on architecture.
Fascinating. You say affecting a person's mind and soul. So, I mean, so far in your studies, have you come to the conclusion that this is the fact now then?
Well, it's hard to make statements like that as fact. I actually am a bit dubious about such claims. That has never, however, stopped an architect from believing it, and I've looked at a number of them that are part of a tradition that sees shape and form as actually responding to some of the most latent impulses of being human. So just the very shape of a room, its dimensions, various ornamentation has a symbolic vocabulary that you know, has an effect on us. Now, I think anybody, even if they were walking into a library or for the first time seeing the Sistine Chapel, there is a certain sense of awe and wonder that comes into a space like that. And there's been an architectural tradition that was largely commented upon in the Renaissance around the 15th century in Italy, where they began espousing a particular doctrine that there was, for instance, this reverberating hum, a harmony in the universe, and that there were certain concordant numbers and spatial formations that was actually the way God had manufactured the universe. And so if there was some way of tapping into that sacred power of harmony and recording it in stone via buildings, mostly chapels and cathedrals, then there is a way of actually placing the hand of God on earth. And so there's it's really quite a rabbit hole of discovery looking at this subject. But perhaps your listeners might be familiar with what's called the Pythagorean tradition, the idea that numbers have a latent power.
Yes, but for
and so mm-hmm. How to and that would just be one component. For instance, in the Manitoba Legislative Building, there are a number of key numbers that repeat throughout the entire architecture, from the plan to the elevation. And in my opinion, it was the architecture, the architect's intention to use this very harmonious system of orientation and proportion so as to kind of tap into what he thought was this cosmic reverberation behind all of creation. So when God created and manufactured the orientation of stars, whatever, God used a particular order, and it was believed that if you recreate this order on Earth, then you are, you know, sympathetically using kind of a divine power. I don't know if that makes much sense. Hopefully, I can get that across.
It's really interesting, Frank. And one question that pops up here right away is, do you think that this is in regards, that this is being done rather in regards to, that this is an effort to communicate with that God, or is this in some other way kind of beneficial to the human being, more than just being kind of aesthetically a pleasure to look at or to be within a space, so to speak?
Yes. Now, precisely. I'm not simply talking about aesthetic pleasure of a well-proportioned room. What I'm referring to is a subject that has gone through the entire architectural tradition from probably one of the seminal books on architecture, which was written about 2,000 years ago by a Roman architect named Vitruvius, who actually used as his template the proportions of the human body. And so you might be familiar, and I'm sure anybody who's ever read the Da Vinci Code or are even slightly familiar with the works of Leonardo da Vinci would immediately clue on to the so-called Vitruvian man,
yes,
which is basically a man in the shape of a kind of star with their arms outstretched and their legs outstretched, circumscribed by a circle and a square. Now, where Da Vinci got this idea of this certain sacred canon to the proportions of the body was from this ancient book of architecture by Vitruvius, and that's why it's called the Vitruvian Man. And so architects believed that there was if there was ever a particular Bible in architecture, it was these writings of Vitruvius, these so-called 10 books of architecture. And these 10 books, Vitruvius highlights that when you want to recreate God's plan on Earth or a temple for God, then you would want to use the proportions of the human body, because if there was ever a more wonderful and beautiful, a perfect specimen of God's creation, then it's the body. And this idea has been commented upon in many ways, and I have to say, I'm usually quite suspicious of outlandish claims that Washington D.C. and everything to do with Roslyn Chapel is all oriented according to the sacred plan. And I think that it gets a little I don't know what your familiarity is with reading about esotericism and architecture, but it's I'm largely put off by it. But there is certainly a longstanding tradition of sacred architecture that thought that there was a way of tapping into recreating the same impulse and order that God used in creating the universe.
Mm-hmm. And I don't know how far back you take it. And you talk about Vitruvius, of course, and. And some people would, I guess, argue that this goes back even further than him and tied back to Egypt, of course. We can talk about the temple at either Luxor or Karnak that have elements of the human body within it. What do you say to that?
Well, actually, the idea that Luxor has is proportioned according to the human body is largely the work of a early 20th century theosophist. Are you familiar with this term?
Yes, this is Svala Deluvich, right, you're talking about?
Yeah. Swaller DeLuvis, who was, for the most part, and I think it's important to give him a fair shake, that he systematically did many years of extremely detailed studies of Karnak, and for a long period of time, they were even head up for respected within certain scholarly circles. But the idea that the Egyptians had used basically the body as the basis for the orientation of the temple was not really at least in the primary material in Egypt until Schwaller came up with this plan. Now, I'm not saying that that's not true and that might not be the case, but there is the pyramids are an extremely wonderful specimen of human ingenuity that I still think to this day we haven't tapped into understanding all of its secrets. So let me, you know, be very clear there. Whether Karnak was duly made according to the proportions of the human body, I am I don't necessarily think I believe that.
Okay, well, how about some of the, I mean, you talk briefly about Washington, D.C. I mean, David Owison, a Freemason, has said that they're definitely, most
is
definitely.
Is he a Freemason?
Yes, he is.
Okay. Not that that, you know, should matter, but sometimes, you know, a large part of Masonic literature is divided in two camps. One is Masons that glorify Freemasonry as being the best thing since sliced bread, or on the flip side of the coin, you know, conspiracy theorists that say Freemasonry is the root of all evil.
Right.
So, okay, well, I didn't know that. Maybe, okay, so he wrote this Zodiacs of the DC or something, correct?
Yes. The thing that I have, as far as I've understood the story, is that Owison actually wrote the book first and discovered all of these things, and it was actually later on that he got initiated, so to speak.
Right. Well, I can understand that, actually, and because when I was undergoing my own research of the Manitoba Legislative Building, I decided at one point, I think it was about 4 years into my investigation, and I was left with a number of resounding questions which mostly circulated around why. Why is this room a perfect square of 66.6 feet in length and 66.6 feet in width, which the architect on his drawings simply wrote 666, which we could get into at some point? Or why would there be a bust of Medusa in the Grand Staircase Hall, as there is in the Manitoba Capitol? And other strange things, like why would he choose to incorporate the cubic dimensions of the Holy of Holies of Solomon's Temple for one room in the building, which is strictly forbidden from the public, which happens to be the case of the Holy of Holies. It was a room that was strictly forbidden from all other temple personnel except for one person, the high priest, who would enter into the room once a year during a time in the Jewish calendar called Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement. So I had all these questions, and I had not considered Freemasonry as being the source of the inspiration behind the design. Because for the most part, I thought if you'd ever mentioned Freemasonry to me, I would have thought, you mean the shrine, the guys that drive around in little cars and have are called the stone cutters on The Simpsons?
Yeah, right.
And a kind of response like that. And so what I did is, I think about 4 years into my investigation, one of my advisors basically said, you know, maybe these guys are Freemasons. I'm like, okay, so who are they? And I began swallowing up as much literature as I could on the subject, and realized, as I mentioned before, that it's mostly divided in two camps. One is, just a condemnation of the entire tradition, or Freemasonry is the greatest thing. Having, you know, my approach in at that point, I just graduated as from my BA in anthropology, and there's one thing that an anthropologist does when they want to investigate a foreign culture, which is they immerse themselves in that culture, you know, partake of their food, drink their, participate in their rites, whatever. So I decided, well, what actually do these Masons do? I mean, what's the big deal here? So I joined.
Oh, there you go.
So I figured, okay, well, what actually do these people do? And I showed up at the Grand Lodge and said, all right, apparently you guys put your symbol on the back of a dollar bill and maybe built the legislative building in Winnipeg. But what actually do you do? And so I became a Mason and joined and went through, I don't think I ascended very far, and I don't think I've been a good Mason. I've only gone to a few meetings. But in the process of going through this very strange, basically a ritual drama that all revolves around the building of King Solomon's temple, I thought that there were elements in the architecture of the building which made complete sense. They were previously anomalies, and they made complete sense only while I was actually going through this apparently old, ancient custom referred to as the mysteries. And so in my own way, I thought, I never would have considered masonry as having been a source of inspiration behind this building until I actually got closer to what actually the organization does.
Yes. So, I mean, okay, some would obviously argue at this point then, those who take the conspiratorial viewpoint, that this will taint your kind of objectivity, so to speak. But
yep.
where do you stand to these days in regards to, you're mentioning these two camps, that they're either they're the best thing or the worst thing. Where do you stand in regards to that now then?
You know, it's a great question. And I think that in any subject, in any discipline, you always have this, whoever the author is, tainted by whatever it is that is their horizon of how they view it. And I think that is always the case in any piece of literature, whether it's some dry, pedantic, academic treatise on the history of wooden shoes, or it's, you know, an apology of Freemasonry or whatever. You're always going to have colored by the author's particular vision.
Sure.
And I think in this case, I could only say that to the best of my abilities, I've followed the most rigorous academic procedures, and mostly ruled by the Occam's razor. You know, the least complicated path is probably the correct one. So if you have a very, very complicated idea that, you know, the Templars built all of these churches and it forms this sacred grid all over the planet, you know, to me that would be a very complicated answer to perhaps something that's much more easier could be explained by other means.
Yes.
But it's a very good question, Heinrich. It's possible that, you know, that this colors my research, but I mean, initially, I'm almost embarrassed to admit this, but I just joined because I wanted access to the archives that
sure.
would have been unavailable to me if I was just a regular Joe.
Well, of
and
course,
so,
and that's
becoming a Mason, I was allowed access to the Grand Lodge archives in Manitoba, which allowed me to continue my research. So I guess you could say it was a bit of a that was maybe a selfish reason for joining.
Well, it's an understandable, way of doing it, so to speak. I definitely understand it, to gain the access and gain the knowledge, if you will. One thing that pops up again here then is obviously, I've heard, from, let's take sources like Albert Pike, for instance, in Morals and Dogma, where we talk about different
right.
levels of dissemination of the information,
yeah.
meaning that on one level you might actually given one message, so to speak, but on another level, the higher up in the degrees or what have you, you actually are given access to another set of information regarding mm-hmm. a symbol or a specific meaning of a ritual or an initiation. What do you think? What do you think that has to do with this? Could it be that you actually, although you are a Freemason, are not given or privy to all the information that is in there? What do you think?
Okay. Now, just as a caveat to that, it was there was another Canadian Masonic scholar by the name of Manly P. Hall that mostly championed that idea that basically Freemasonry was a kind of system of mysteries that you did not know the next level of the mystery unless you kind of ascended through the ranks.
Yes.
And I think on the subject of Albert Pike, I have to say that he is, I think, thrown around way too loosely as being a kind of, one of the grand supreme magus of all of Freemasonry. And this isn't entirely true. He had an enormous impact and it was of noted importance on the dissemination of Scottish Rite ritual in the southern jurisdiction in the United States. He is a Masonic pundit par excellence in the United States, but he is at all no representative of world Freemasonry, as he's often described. And if you read any conspiracy book on the Freemasons, Albert Pike is always right in there, right away, and you hear about him, you know, extolling Luciferian energies and that he is this world supreme grand magus of all Freemasonry. Mm. And, you know, this isn't representative at all of Freemasonry. And for the most part, most people don't even know that there aren't just 33 degrees. There are thousands of degrees.
Probably, yeah.
Thousands. Maybe something like 1,200 different degrees. Mm. And so, for instance, even in your country, which in fact probably, in my opinion, has the oldest and perhaps the most authentic ritual degree system of Freemasonry. In your country, it's a 7-degree system. It's not a 33-degree system. It's not a 3-degree system as it is here in the UK. And there isn't these deviant, spurious rites. There are seven degrees, and your particular Grand Lodge archive is very hush-hush on the nature of the system there. And from as far as I can gather, I think probably is the most authentic representation of Freemasonry from this transition from what's often called operative Freemasonry into
yes.
what is called speculative Freemasonry.
Yes.
And so, anyways, there are hundreds of degrees. Some degrees have women, some degrees invoke angels, some degrees use Kabbalistic formulas, some degrees have alchemy, all of which Albert Pike would not have known about and did not spend his time discussing. And so certainly the core of your statement to me rings true, that there are elements within the craft that you would that the mystery unfolds as you move through the grades.
Sure.
But a lot of those grades and a lot of the rituals, like, say, the 33-degree system, they were inventions. They were, inventions in the 18th century, early 19th century, like John Yarker. There are many figures that were these disseminators of Masonic rituals, but they actually wrote them. Now, in terms of, like, kind of authenticity of early operative Masonry, I mean, Masonry that we know was involved, were responsible for some of the great cathedrals in Europe, and that there were certain password signs and tokens that the various grades needed to know in order to ascend up those ranks. That transition into speculative Freemasonry, to me, is much more interesting, and as far as we could tell, it was probably a 3 or perhaps 4-degree system, and perhaps, if anything, maybe something closer to the system of rites that you have in Sweden.
Mm, that is interesting. And I actually did only know or think that there was only 3 degrees in Sweden, or at least the 3 different lodges with the St. Andreas Lodge. You have the Johannes Lodge, and then you have the one initiatory, I think, degree step or lodge or whatever. But 7, that was interesting. Okay, I need to check up on that.
Yes.
And then,
you know, there were rites that were done in a grotto, in a garden setting. There were rites that were done in a subterranean cavern. There were rites that were done in a whole host of ways. And for instance, one particular, in my opinion, which has a clear line of lineage to the design of the Manitoba Legislative Building, is the history of the floor cloth. Now, are you familiar with this particular Masonic paraphernalia?
Remind me and our listeners about it, if you will.
Okay, well, basically, the floor cloth is this a rug, a type of rug that around the 18th century what designated the sacred space of the lodge. Now, there wasn't such a thing as temples or lodges in the 18th century. And most people, for instance, in the time of the Enlightenment, that gravitated towards Freemasonry were scientists, poets, engineers, philosophers, and some of the greatest minds of that period had gravitated towards Freemasonry. It was a time of total explosion. And so what would happen is that Freemasons would meet in a tavern or at somebody's home. And in order to designate the sacred space of the lodge, they would draw in chalk on the floor the various orientations, the position of east, and certain signs that would be traced onto the floor that would basically indicate they were like mnemonic devices, kind of memory devices that would allow the ritual procedure to move forward. So kind of like cue cards if ever a person got stuck on their lines. Mm. Now, and so what happened was, because there were papal bans against Freemasonry in 1738, I believe there was one, and I think 5 years earlier, so the Pope had completely denounced Freemasonry as being entirely diabolical, whatever, and it would lead to error and sin. And so what would happen was that Masons would meet in a place that was designated by this tracing board, and if ever the cops were to show up, they could quickly, or would I, you know, I'm making kind of jests here, they could just quickly erase the tracing, and you know, it's just basically a tavern room. Mm-hmm. And then what would happen is that they developed these cloths where they would roll the cloth out, and the cloth would have various different signs that would indicate that degree. So in the first degree, there would be a particular cloth. The second degree, there would be a particular cloth with various signs that would be symbolic of that degree. And so what happened here at this time is that there wasn't actually any formation of a Grand Lodge yet. There were no designs for lodges, whatever. So they mm-hmm. needed to designate the sacred space in a symbolic way. And Masons were involved, some of them, at least in France and Germany, in taking the sacred space of the lodge and projecting it into the landscape. And so there were a number of gardens and even cemeteries that were designed by Masons to follow a particular route of initiation. Mm-hmm. So there are a number of gardens in just outside of Paris, for instance, that if you and I were to wander through them, we would, you know, walk down a kind of circuitous path, and then lo and behold, suddenly we'd see this giant obelisk or a giant pyramid, and then we'd descend into a grotto and move through these kind of murky waters of the grotto and follow the light, and as we move up and ascend into the light, we'd encounter another, they were called fabriques, these kind of garden designs, mm-hmm. and they were very enchanting, and people went nuts for them, like Thomas Jefferson and Marie Antoinette would visit these places and think about philosophical things and a place of kind of respite. But the intention behind them, in many cases, they were designed as a kind of ritualistic subliminal message. As you walked through the garden, you were meant to encounter these things and be in awe of them, because in some way this sign would have an impact on you. And so it was a way of kind of publicly initiating people into Freemasonry without actually going through the degrees. So they took this kind of sacred space of the floor cloth, the tracing board, kind of projected it into the landscape, and in the process of doing that, they were able to kind of disseminate Masonic secrets, Masonic ideas, like Mozart did with his magic flute, mm-hmm. like incorporated Masonic ideology, Masonic ideas into this play. So you go attend this play, and you be familiar with the various stages of the play, not knowing that the whole time you are getting a kind of discourse on Freemasonry. And so this innovation to actually take Freemasonry, which is entirely about architecture and about design, I mean, architecture is a way of salvation in Freemasonry, is to actually take these principles and not just enclose it in a sacred space called the Grand Lodge or the Lodge or the place where initiations take place, but putting it in a public space so that other people, perhaps even unbeknownst to them, are being introduced to the sacred mysteries of Freemasonry through these signs and whatever. Mm. That, to me, is the much more interesting side of the craft, which is is not discussed. You mostly have these kind of more of a sensational angle on that. Oh, it's, you know, to pollute your mind and whatever. And as far as I could tell, I think that the intentions, for the most part, were benevolent. Sorry, I went on a rant there.
No.
You want to edit some of that stuff out?
No, definitely not. That is very interesting, and thank you very much for sharing that. I didn't know that. And these gardens you were talking about, I mean, were these, I mean, who, what type of people are we, or were, do you think that they were addressing here? Are these gardens in front of, mansions or even castles or places, or are these just public open spaces around cities or in cities?
No. Well, in some cases, they were public spaces, and for the most part, these gardens were private dwellings of mostly the aristocracy, and so they would be places that you would be invited to go, and if you were lucky to go, and it would be a kind of there was this very famous French philosopher named Rousseau who said, you know, we need to return to our kind of noble heritage. He coined something called the noble savage, he glorified the idea that, you know, here everybody thought that in Enlightenment Europe and in this kind of great rise of science and all these great wise things and traditions, that Rousseau, who is a very important French philosophical thinker,
yes,
said, well, actually, perhaps we're regressing because we have people that are more concerned with the frill on their dress and the type of perfume to wear, and we're not actually returning to our noble origins, and that even these savages that we're getting stories about in the Caribbean and other parts of the world, maybe those people are even more enlightened and more true to the kind of nature of being human than others. And so and he had a large audience of people that listened to that, and so he would one of the things he advocated is to return to nature as it is, because in the process of returning to nature as it is, we would kind of recover our true origins.
Mm.
And so a lot of these gardens, they look like, I mean, from the surface, they look like they are like the common word to describe them is picturesque. Oh, they look like just these wonderful rolling hills, and you move down these hills, and they're this ruined, old ruined temple. And then you walk further, and then there's this, you know, this wonderful display of rocks, and it's supposed to look like it's been like untarnished by nature. But the fact is that it was intentionally contrived to look like nature had formed it, and that was the idea of kind of using that as a way to disseminate enlightened ideas, because he was advocating returning to the gardens, and so there was this idea of kind of, or returning to kind of pristine nature, is that using that as a place to, as a, like almost like a canvas to project Masonic ideas, is to me an amazing innovation that we've only just begun to tap into. So people get really, I think, perhaps too enthused about things like Washington, D.C., and if for instance, on that subject, if you did want to read a very sensible account of the, for instance, the U.S. Capitol building and the Masonic designs of that, I would, you know, recommend your listeners to a particular author who happens to be my supervisor, who wrote a very sensible architectural treatment on how the Capitol building was kind of designed to the three rooms, the Senate chamber, the rotunda, and now I forget what the other, I believe it's the old chamber, I forget what it is, were basically a kind of symbolic way of moving through the three degrees of initiation, the three Masonic grades.
Right.
But and as I said before, there are many greats. Anyways, I'm probably getting way over ahead of myself, and I would like to talk about the building at some point.
Yeah, I know. We haven't even kind of dived into that yet. But let's. I have a few more questions, and then let's get to it, okay?
Sure.
Because one thing you're saying here then is that the symbolism are more prevalent in a way than what we believe at first. In one regard, we can say that the people who are designing the cities are in many cases they have a background in Freemasonry, have been studying it in some way, or even, you know, being that they are coming from an educated in architecture, that means that automatically you get some of this with you, so to speak, from those schools. But there are people who would argue that these ancient rites, if we talk about the mysteries or even the teachings themselves, argue that this is something that actually really doesn't belong to Freemasonry to begin with. Some argue that the mysteries or teachings have even been kind of hijacked, if you will, and to this day are being used and in some regard even misrepresented. Misrepresented. What would you say to that, Frank?
Well, the idea that Freemasonry is part of this tradition of the great ancient mystery cults of Egypt and Eleusis and Rome first emerged actually in Masonic literature, and it was a way of Masons kind of puffing up their own institution, saying we didn't just start with the builders of Solomon's Temple. And so if you take probably the most important piece of Masonic catechism, which is James Anderson's 1723 edition of the Constitutions of the Freemasons, he basically starts Freemasonry with Adam. Adam was the first Freemason, and then there was Noah, and all of these guys basically were given this oral tradition of God's laws into built works. And so, to me, I don't think that there's this to me, for the most part, is you know, Masons build, you know, puffing up their own institution that it came from these ancient mysteries. But if there are others that say that Freemasonry has hijacked these other ancient mystery cults, they are themselves basically falling for the Masonic advertising.
Right. Well, exactly. Because what I'm thinking of here is something that Martin Short wrote about in, I think, one of his books, and he talks about this constitution that you mentioned, the Freemasonic Constitution, that in many cases actually was, as far as his research went, that was actually not, there was more kind of an invention, and it there was a previous constitution that was based on what is known as the Gothic Constitution that he argued was the more kind of authentic one, and that has to do with the more of the of the real builder, so to speak, but the Freemasonic Constitutions was basically, if you will, an invention, and this is something that's kind of slowly has been propped up. What would you say to that?
Well, I would agree, and I think that if you were to take, for instance, a very very popular piece of Masonic mythology, is that the Masons, that the Templars, are the kind of early descendants, the 12th century descendants of the Masonic craft, that they had discovered something during their researches at the stables of King Solomon's Temple, or where they thought were the stables of King Solomon's Temple in Jerusalem, and the process of discovering this coveted knowledge, then eventually after being annihilated by King Philip of France, they journeyed off to Scotland and remained in hiding, only to emerge many centuries later as the Freemasons.
Yes.
So there was this idea that Freemasons are directly linked to the Templars. Now, no medievalist worth their salt would ever actually agree with that. There's a huge gap of time between the excommunication of the Templars and the first recorded Masonic initiation of the speculative variety, which was around 1647 or something like that. Now, to me, what really started and spawned this whole kind of Templar connection was this 18th century Freemason who basically gave a public speech and said, "Oh, our institution began first. You know, the Templars have held it, but they got it from the first century Gnostics, who got it from these wandering Egyptian sages and whatnot." Mm. And so it was a piece of Masonic mythology that entered into scholarship as being authoritatively true, not completely forgetting that it was this guy who invented it around 250 years ago and said that Freemasonry has everything to do with the Templars. Now, I don't want to dismiss that altogether, because I think there are way too many parallels between the Templars and the Freemasonry to think that there is there should be some connection, but unfortunately, and as a historian, the information is very paltry, and so I have to concede that there until we can actually find a direct lineage, the gap of time between the Templars and the Masons are way too great, and so I don't think that there's any connection between these two. I would think that if there was, we would have evidence of it, kind of like in the same way that if there was King David the way the Bible portrays him,
mm-hmm.
then surely we have some kind of historical record of this King David, but we have zero, nothing, nada. The entire Middle East, the most we've ever got on King David is one piece of ostracon, a basically broken fragment of pottery that has the basically the three Hebrew letters for David on it. And then people go, oh my gosh, it's evidence of King David. It's like, wait
right.
a second.
Right.
King David is way too prolific a king. He had the territory all over the place. If we follow the Bible, surely we should have more than this. We have everything on some nobody Egyptian mayor in some outpost town in the Upper Nile. We have tons on him and tons on other nobodies in the ancient world. Surely we should have something on David or Moses or even Solomon, and
yeah.
we have nothing. And the same thing is with the Templars. We have zero connecting them with the Masons, other than a lot of conjecture and a lot of Masonic mythologizing and in the ritual that makes that connection.
Well, right. Well, exactly. But what kind of questions, do you ask to that then in that regard? Because does that mean that they're just trying to prop up the order for the sake of it, or to offer these mysteries or symbols, or would you argue that this is just, these stories aren't to be meant to be taken literal, but this is about a teaching or to relay information regarding these kings, and they're not really looked upon as historical characters or figures per se. What do you think?
I think that if you or I were interested in joining a secret society that apparently had coveted knowledge that came directly from God, would we be interested in joining if we found out that 50 years earlier some dude invented it, made all
nope.
these connections and wrote down the ritual and how we were supposed to go about it, and they had like trial tests and everything?
Mm.
Of course not.
No.
This is bunk.
Yeah.
I want to get the real stuff. And that's basically how Freemasonry has grown. It has grown through a series of repeated reinventions, mythologizing, and there are certain characters that don't appear until much later. And it's quite interesting. So, people that do Masonic research always mention Hiram Abiff, the so-called
yes.
Chief architect of King Solomon's temple.
Mm.
There is a reference of a Hiram of Tyre who is... worked on King Solomon's temple according to the Bible, but Masons have invented an entire mythology, a huge and very complex and elaborate mythology of who this king was, who this
Builder.
Master architect was, and that
yeah.
he was killed by three ruffians, and he refused to give the secret word, the Mason's word, and other things, and so he was killed, and so the ritual degrees of Freemasonry, at least one of the degrees, recreates this murderous act, and then you, the candidate, becomes the architect, the chief architect of Solomon's temple, and you're killed and raised from the dead. That entire tradition, we can actually point to when it started and how it changed in different rituals and traditions.
Yeah.
Most people see Freemasonry as being this umbrella that all of Freemasonry is the same, and so they could use somebody like Albert Pike and use him as a kind of exponent of all world Freemasonry.
Right.
And it's way too complex, way too many traditions, too many cultures and civilizations that have changed it, modified the rituals, whatever,
yeah.
to ever think that Albert Pike, one guy from the mid 19th century. Backwater southern United States could in any way be a representative of all of these different degrees and all these different things.
Right, right, exactly. Well, I agree with you that it's more complicated than that, and it's all about, if you will, then cherry picking. But again, it's like he is venerated. There are statues here and there of him, and so I understand that
the
questions are there. So obviously, yeah. But one thing I did want to just comment on here was the factor you talked about. I found the reference here. Dr. James Anderson was born in Aberdeen in about 1680, and he was actually a minister in the Church of Scotland at that time. And he is, as far as I understand, then kind of responsible, if you will, for creating the Freemasonic Constitution and writing it up, and also in that regard, kind of creating, if you will, the story of Hiram Abiff, and that this was not actually something that popped up in a Gothic constitution, which he kind of...
He doesn't create Hiram Abiff, though. Another figure does.
Okay.
That happens a bit later.
Do you know who that was, who did that?
I believe...
Wasn't it James Anderson Jr., actually?
Well, yeah, he was a minister, and that was the other thing, is that a lot of people tend to see Freemasonry and the church as being on opposite ends of the table, and the thing is that there were a lot of, and in many cases, the great pundits of Freemasonry over the last three centuries were, or a number of them were, ministers.
Yes, yes.
The thing is that it's really Freemasonry and Catholicism that had that basically weren't bosom buddies. But in the case of, I believe the first time that we ever get any indication that there was a Hiram is from this other figure named James Pritchard, who wrote a book called Masonry Dissected. It's not really a book. It's basically an exposure. Are you familiar with this?
No, I haven't heard about it.
Well, exposures are these... they're basically ex-Masons or that write about the mysteries and document what actually it is that Masons do.
Yeah.
Even today, right now, like, people talk, oh, the 33 degrees of Freemasonry and all this kind of wild stuff about the mysteries. Every single one of those rituals are online. You can read it.
Yeah.
They're, like, on the web. And they're, like, open for display. And
right.
Already in, I think, 1747, when Pritchard writes his book, or this exposure, he basically introduces the public for the first time to this guy named Hiram, which in the earlier rituals doesn't appear.
Yeah.
So we know that Hiram was pretty much invented around, I think, around the 1630s. I think Pritchard, it might be 1630s. My dates aren't entirely on this. But this basically, this exposure sets up a legacy of other exposures. You have a number of people throughout the last 2.5 centuries that write these accounts that then they'll present illustrations.
Yes.
And so I have illustrations, for instance, in my book that come out of a 18th century French exposure. Some guy who decides, you know what, I'm publishing this stuff. People, the public loves it. This is sensational stuff. You know, Mozart, Ben Franklin, Washington, all these guys are Masons. What is it they do? I'm going to publish the rituals and actually provide illustrations with them.
Mm.
So for the most part, anybody who is diligent in the research can find out every single degree and what it is that they do, except perhaps maybe not in Sweden. As I mentioned before, you guys are very tight-lipped on your own tradition that has an effect on us. Now, I think anybody, even if they were walking into a library or for the first time seeing the Sistine Chapel, there is a certain sense of awe and wonder that comes into a space like that. And there's been an architectural tradition that was largely commented upon in the Renaissance around the 15th century in Italy, where they began espousing a particular doctrine that there was, for instance, this reverberating hum, a harmony in the universe, and that there were certain concordant numbers and spatial formations that was actually the way God had manufactured the universe. And so if there was some way of tapping into that sacred power of harmony and recording it in stone via buildings, mostly chapels and cathedrals, then there is a way of actually placing the hand of God on earth. And so there's it's really quite a rabbit hole of discovery looking at this subject. But perhaps your listeners might. Certainly, it's always a pleasure to talk about the hermetically sealed subject.
Absolutely. I'm looking forward to this very much here. So why don't we begin just talk a little bit about yourself, kind of tell us a little bit about your background and how you got involved in some of this research, Frank.
Certainly. Well, I'm presently a doctoral student at the University of Cambridge in England. And if somebody had asked me 5 years ago that I'd be exploring the Masonic and Freemasonic influences in public architecture, I would have thought, you know, that's absolutely ludicrous. But basically, I was spawned on this subject about 6 years ago when I stumbled upon some rather arcane symbolism that adorns a legislative building in my hometown of Winnipeg. What happened was I just noted these two giant Egyptian sphinxes that flank the front entrance of this building, and at that time I was doing a master's degree in basically the Hebrew Bible and the ancient Middle East, and so over the last 6 years I've sort of been on an academic...
...that this is being done rather in regards to... that this is an effort to communicate with that God, or is this in some other way kind of beneficial to the human being, more than just being kind of aesthetically a pleasure to look at or to be within a space, so to speak?
Yes. Now, precisely. I'm not simply talking about aesthetic pleasure of a well-proportioned room. What I'm referring to is a subject that has gone through the entire architectural tradition from probably one of the seminal books on architecture, which was written about 2,000 years ago by a Roman architect named Vitruvius, who actually used as his template the basis, the proportions of the human body. And so you might be familiar, and I'm sure anybody who's ever read the Da Vinci Code or are even slightly familiar with the works of Leonardo da Vinci would immediately clue on to the so-called Vitruvian man,
yes,
which is basically a man in the shape of a kind of star with their arms outstretched and their legs out, like Odyssey, trying to figure out how... this building relates to a much larger question, which is it possible that architecture and buildings and form can affect a person's mind, their soul, whatever? So the subject of my research presently is basically looking at the Western esoteric tradition, in particular Freemasonry, and its impact on architecture.
Fascinating. You say affecting a person's mind and soul. So, I mean, so far in your studies, have you come to the conclusion that this is the fact now, then?
Well, it's hard to make statements like that as fact. I actually am a bit dubious about such claims. That has never, however, stopped an architect from believing it, and I've looked at a number of them that are part of a tradition that sees shape and form as actually responding to some of the most latent impulses of being human. So just the very shape of a room, its dimensions, various ornamentation has a symbolic vocabulary. Be familiar with what's called the Pythagorean tradition, the idea that numbers have a latent power.
Yes. But for
and so how to, and that would just be one component. For instance, in the Manitoba Legislative Building, there are a number of key numbers that repeat throughout the entire architecture from the plan to the elevation. And in my opinion, it was the architecture, the architect's intention to use this very harmonious system of orientation and proportion so as to kind of tap into what he thought was this cosmic reverberation behind all of creation. So when God created and manufactured the orientation of stars, whatever, God used a particular order And it was believed that if you recreate this order on Earth, then you are, you know, sympathetically using kind of a divine power. I don't know if that makes much sense.
Well,
I can get that across.
It's really interesting, Frank. And one question that pops up here right away is, do you think that this is in regard